Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, ma'am Hevasa, for having me here. Let me first apologize for shifting the date from 26th to today. Initially, your freshers day was supposed to be on 26th. I did not realize that it was the day when we were having a legislative assembly session. So I had to request her at the last moment that we need to probably change. She and all of you were kind enough to accommodate me, and I'm grateful for that. I think I can't motivate you more than what Hevasa has already done. She's basically crystallized everything that you need to do. Yes, you are 800 of you new students who have joined the mainstream college this year. 800 is not a small number, but it is not a big number. After all, we are just a speck in the ocean. We are nobodies. There are certain things in Nagaland which are undergoing a change, which students need to, or youngsters like you all need to be aware of. She's mentioned a few. Let me begin by saying that nothing in this world is permanent. The only permanent is change. So whether you want it or not, change will always keep happening around you. Nagaland as a society has been in the throes of change, as other societies are. But the pace at which change has been taking place in Nagaland has been phenomenal. I always say that Nagas are at a stage where Nagas have been hit by a future shock. What other cultures and societies have achieved by way of, say, 2000 years of civilization, Nagas are trying to compress this into a 150 years of time span. So there is a mix of everything in the society. There is a mix of modernity, there is a mix of tribalism, there is a mix of primitive life, there is a mix of old and new, which puts everyone at crossroads. I think a lot of things have to be seen in a particular context. If we forget the context and start seeing things just as they stand today in isolation, we are all committing a mistake. I remember when Dr. Anirudh invited me for this lecture, online lecture last year, on policing in Nagaland in the modern context. Now, it was a very hard and difficult choice to make. Because the policing is not unaffected by what is going on. There is the constitutional protection of 371A, where customs and traditions have to be preserved. And then there is this modern state. How do you reconcile both of these? Would you want all your crimes or all your deviant behavior to be dealt with by traditional law or by the customary law? Or would you want to go to the modern new institutions? That is a dilemma that all of you will face. That is a dilemma that all of us face. Yes, a theft will always remain a theft. I think I'm starting with that because I don't think too many of you may have listened to that interaction. So certain basic things that I need to tell you so that you understand how things are changing. Yes, a theft will always remain a theft, and a theft traditionally in all societies has been a theft. It can be punished by customary and traditional laws also. But the issue is, which type of theft do you want to punish by customary or traditional law? Did you have mobile phones in the past? Did you have mobile phones, or did any one of us have mobile phones in the past? No. Did we have cars in the past? No. Did we have, in Nagaland context, did we have RCC buildings like this, glass buildings like this in the past, say about 20 years ago, 50 years ago? No. So the point is, if there is a theft taking place of a mobile phone, would you want to punish that criminal as per your customary law, or would you want to go to the police? So that is a choice you have to make. There were no mobile phones in the past in the customary law. So if you punish the theft of a mobile phone or a Fortuner or a Bolero or a Tata or a bus or a JCB under customary law, it will cause miscarriage of justice. This is where the context changes, and when the context changes, everything else needs to change. To substantiate my point, taking it of the whole logic a bit further, if all of us were to punish every criminal as per customary law, then why do we need police? Then why do we need judiciary? So there is a big requirement, there is a big need that we should try to adapt to change. When we are trying to adapt to change, we need to be sure about what change we need to adopt, which change we need to embrace. I have seen and I know that in traditional societies, not Nagaland alone, but traditional societies, consumption of things like alcohol and opium and all were a given thing. But do you think, or do your parents think, that it is the right thing to do? It is not. It is not morally the right thing to do. It is not the right thing to do for your health. That is why everybody will stop you from consuming, say, liquor or tobacco or opium or drugs. So when you have to make a choice, you have to be sure about what choices you are going to make. That is where your parents, your elders, your teachers, and the ideals in the society will help. That is where they will guide you. Finally, it is for up to you to make a choice, but they will always put the choices on the table for you. That is where there is a need, there is a requirement for discussion, for debates, and even divergent views on various issues. I think this is something that I feel is lacking in Nagaland as such. Again, I'm not commenting on individual brilliance or lack of brilliance, but can I ask a few questions? How many of you watch television daily? I think everybody. TV? How many of you watch TV? Just raise your hands. And how many of you, very few, but how many of you watch news channels daily or watch news daily? This will be even fewer. Now, how do you keep yourselves abreast of what is happening in the society? Our society, or any society, has changed a lot. It has changed a lot from my village to my country and my world. And my world interacts with every other person around us. So if we don't know what is happening in the world, what is happening around us, we will look like fools. You know, honestly, it pains me that a lot of effort has been made by some young IPS officers and IAS officers in Nagaland to push you, pull you, train you, coach you, youngsters, to appear for the civil services. And unfortunately, in the past, say, 4-5 years, there has been just one success, which was last year. I think the biggest reason for that is lack of exposure. You know, if you don't watch news, you don't watch TV, you don't watch a few, read a few newspapers. I'm not talking about local Nagaland newspapers like Nagaland Post, Murung. I mean, without any ill will towards them. They only cover the local news. When you go and prepare for the civil services or for competitive exams, they're not going to ask you questions about Nagaland. What is my tribe, my village, my father's name, my chief minister? No. They're going to ask you about the entire world, what is happening in the world. And you are losing out on that experience by not exposing yourself to TV, to newspapers, internet, online newspapers, not local newspapers. You have to have a broader view of things. You know, this is where the real change in Nagaland will come in. You know, again, not a commentary on my fellow bureaucrats in Nagaland, my fellow seniors and my colleagues on Nagaland, but my observation is a lot of us who have not gone beyond Nagaland and served in other places in Nagaland don't know what is happening in Nagaland. What are the solutions to the problems that we face? So what happens is that when there is a problem, we think it is the end of the world. Nothing can be done. But if we just look beyond us, there are ready solutions available everywhere. You know, I'll give you an example now. If there are anyone from the media, please don't quote me out of context. I'm just giving you an example of how things are different in different parts of the country. And we have not adopted or embraced that change. Now, some years ago, there was this discussion about inner line permits. Now, whether the inner line permits will be allowed or they should be relaxed or opened, or what should be the inner line permit regime. So, the question was, what about illegal immigrants? You know? Now, firstly, it is difficult to define who is an illegal immigrant. In case of Nagaland, we generally think illegal immigrant is a Bangladeshi. Now, not only Nagaland, but in the entire country, it is like essentially, say, a Muslim guy with a dhoti or a small beard will be considered as, in Nagaland particularly, illegal Bangladeshi immigrant. But an illegal Bangladeshi immigrant is the same like an illegal Myanmarese immigrant also. So there is no difference between an illegal immigrant of any country. But the point is, how do you decide who is an illegal immigrant? There are two ways to decide. One is, know who is an illegal immigrant. Naam pura jane, itukhan asej, that is one thing. The other is, if we know who is not an illegal immigrant, who is an Indian national, then everybody else will be an illegal immigrant. Okay. Now, the issue was, how do we decide whether an immigrant coming for a work permit or an inner line permit to Nagaland is a genuine Indian national? You know, and we were at our wit's end, our friends were at their wit's end deciding how to decide that. We have no means of verifying. And this is about 6-7 years ago. And it was like, if you send a request to them, the police station where this fellow says, I belong to, the police will not reply in the next 1 month. By that time, he will settle down in the society. You know, again, this was a classical case where lack of exposure, lack of knowledge about certain things happening elsewhere in the country or in the world was a handicap in a solution. Now, I belong to Himachal Pradesh. My father is originally from Haryana, from a small village in Haryana. And I gave this example to my friends. The property which my father has will someday come to me, right? I will inherit that property. Now, all those property records are computerized by the government in Haryana and are available on the internet, on the website. Which means if someone wants to check whether Rupin Sharma is an illegal immigrant or an Indian national, you just have to ask me, Rupin Sharma, what is your father's name? What is your village name? You go to that website and check that father's name and that village name. If I am saying I am the son of my father, obviously I am an Indian. You know, so there are solutions which are available. But if you don't want to look at solutions, then there are no solutions available. There are ready solutions available. We have to look at solutions. So, some of you are here, you probably finish your college studies from here. Some of you may go for postgrads outside. What you learn from outside, bring it back to Nagaland. I'm not saying everything. Yes, you can learn everything, good and bad, both. But whatever is good outside, bring it back to Nagaland and implement. And what is bad outside, bring it to Nagaland and say, please don't do this. There is a learning in what is bad also. So keep your eyes and ears open. I would suggest, I would request the college management. I said this in the principals, college principals association meet also where I went. I think Nagaland, there is a dire need for creating an environment for debate and declamations, for open discussions among students. Out of those open discussions, only new solutions will come. Out of those open solutions, only your own personality will develop. Your thought process will develop. You will start questioning things which are happening around you. Questioning things is very important to learn more. In my case personally, my default reaction for anything is probably a no. But it is not a full stop to the conversation. A no from my side is the beginning of a conversation because I want to get more information about things. If I say something and no, then I want to get more information about that thing. Now, at your age, as madam has said, that your age is impressionable. This is an age where the influence of parents and teachers is less. The influence that you have among each other is more. You learn more from each other, whether that whatever you learn is good or bad. So make sure that you are in good company. Make sure that to protect a friend who is doing something wrong, you don't shield him. At least inform someone. You know, it is not chugli. It is not chugli. If you are a good friend of someone, you will probably point out his mistake, or to him or her, or to someone who is interested in him, his parents or someone, you know, so that change in behavior, that correct change in behavior can take place. So that is essential. Now, a few things that I would request you not to indulge in. Alcoholism is one. This is not an age where you can take to alcoholism. Drugs and smoking is another one. Please don't do it. You are not enjoying your life. You are just spoiling your lives and spoiling the lives of your parents. Your hard-earned money, you are spoiling. Develop a habit of questioning. If any one of you is coming to the college in a Mercedes car, please ask your parents, go back and ask your parents, where is this money for the Mercedes coming from? Because I'm sure that except a handful of, say, 10 odd families, none of us can afford a Mercedes. Even I can't afford. If I don't have an official Mercedes, I will not be able to afford one. And I don't have an official Mercedes also. So, but the point is, you should start questioning, you know, the drugs, liquor, cigarettes, avoid. Learn to be punctual. Discipline is not about just following the orders. Discipline is also about questioning something which is wrong. If there is something which is wrong, always question it. Always ask. I mean, my request to the faculty here would be, I've faced this problem myself. As a student, I've faced this problem myself. If a student questions a teacher, the teacher should not take offense to it. If the teacher was good enough, if the student was good enough himself, he will not ask you. So I'll give you a personal example, a problem that I faced. I was in college. This was my final year in college, BSc, and we had our practicals of botany. I was one of the better students in the class. So our practical session was in the evening. So there was a morning practical session, there was an evening session. So we went about an hour early. And from the morning shift students, we asked them what are the questions being asked for the viva. And they told us 2-3 questions and nobody was able to answer one particular question. So naturally we tried to look at the answer. This is like 87. So there were no internet where you can find out answers very quickly now. So we tried to do our best, tried to find the answers. We could not find the answer. So, and between two of us, my friend and me, we decided that if the external examiner questions us, we will politely tell him, sir, we don't know the answer. So this is what happened. So he, the gentleman, the external examiner, asked us this question. I remember one of the words was fermentation. The other words was something. He wanted the difference between fermentation and one more word. I'm forgetting that. So I didn't know that. So I said, sir, I don't know. So he said, no, you should know. You are the best student in the class. I said, sir, I'm sorry, I don't know. He kept insisting. And there was a point where I broke down. And I said, sir, sorry, I don't know. Can you please explain to me? No, this was a very genuine question in good faith asked from a teacher. It is not out of anger or putting him, showing him in a bad place. In my viva, out of 30, he gave me 10. He was to fail me. Just because I asked him this question, he would have failed me. But if I had known that answer, I would have answered him straight away. So my request to the teachers is that every time a student questions you, doesn't mean that he is questioning your authority. He is not questioning your authority nor your knowledge. He just might not know the answer. So an honest introspection and an honest answer will encourage the student to come back to you for solving his problem or solving for taking advice on various issues. I think she's spoken about focus with one eye. I don't know whether it should be one eye or two eyes, but if you have something in mind, then I think your mind and both your eyes should be on that target. And if you are not having any aims, yeah, then it's good to have one eye on that and one eye somewhere else. But if you know what you want to achieve, then it is best to focus on anything that you want to achieve. Let me end here, but I've sought ma'am's permission that if any student wants to ask me something, I am open to questions for the next 2-3 minutes. If any one of you wants to ask me, you can stand up, raise your hand, ask me. You don't have questions, or you don't want to ask, or you are shy.
Very good afternoon to everyone, and thank you, sir, for this opportunity. My name is Madhuri Chichi from BFE semester political sciences, my honors. So my question to you, sir, is, sir, can you give an IATO experience from your service? From your service, or anything like what experience?
Okay. So he's come take, it is working now. So he's saying for expiring candidates, tips for expiring candidates for civil services. Firstly, let me admit that I am too old to give any tips. Things have changed. A lot of water has flown down the river. But yes, I have given you one tip already. Focus is one thing, but I think more important than focus is that you should know your capabilities and your limitations. You should know whether you can do it or not. If you cannot do it, if you have a doubt in your mind, please keep away from it, because you will be wasting 4 years or 5 years of your life. Okay, so in life in general, not only for civil services, but in life in general, all of us need to know what we are capable of doing and what we are not capable of doing also. That, I think, is the biggest strength of a personality of an individual. If you know what you can do,
And if you know what you cannot do, you will succeed. Because you will succeed where you can do something. Okay? So beyond this, I mean, follow your mind. If you are good in mathematics, do mathematics. If you are good in psychology, do psychology. But don't do mathematics if you can't follow mathematics. I mean, for me, I am very afraid of figures. Nothing, when there are figures, I don't even look at that side. So I know that is my limitation. So I don't do that. But whatever is your strength, do it. Whether it is civil services or anything else. If you want to aspire for civil services, you want any help, the best way is to talk to the younger officers of the past 4-5 years batches, because they would know what is the pattern of the examination and other things. We would not know. We are too old. Things have changed a lot from since then. Anyone else? I hope I am able to satisfy you. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, because I don't want to misguide anyone. Anyone else? Last but not the least, if any one of you, what I can do for all of you or any one of you is be a friend. I'm there on Facebook, I'm there on Twitter, I'm there on the social media. Any one of you wants any personal help or advice or want to share anything with me, something where you want to share in anonymity where nobody else should know, most welcome to approach me, send me a messenger message. This is what I can do. I can't do anything else for you. Thank you very much.